unite our humanness and our mixture and our frailty and our finiteness to something that's bigger than us. And that it's like a spiral. The more we do that, the more we can say yes.
May I say hallelujah?
Amen.
I was reminded of a nice Sufism teaching, and it was said that doctrine and faith are really important, but if you have love, you really don't need them.
Exactly.
How do you define the heart? You talked about the brain, you talked about the self, you talked about the soul, and how, where would the heart be at? And I thought you might talk about the God gene, that whole discussion. So the heart, what is the heart to you? Or how do you explain the God gene?
So I would go back to that embodied connection between heart and brain, and God for that matter. The sense that our heart, I always am going to go to Walter Rahner. Rahner actually says the heart is the symbol of the human person. So I'm going to use that language as well. So I mean, our heart is an organ that pumps blood through our bodies. We also now know that it's an intelligent organ that has a network of neurons surrounding it that's connected to our brain, and that we feel things. I mean, I don't know about you, but I can speak from my own personal experience that when I feel something deeply, I do that sort of that clenching, that twinge right in my heart. I would connect it to that. But I would say in that, because of the deeper meaning heart has taken on in our language and in our culture, I would say that the heart is ultimately a symbol of the human person. It is who we are as persons. So I would say it's integrally connected to what it means to be spirit. And I want to go back to the Sufi quote too, just for a moment, to say, when I say I'm coming at this from a Christian perspective, I think that there are a lot of other world religions that say the same thing. And I'm not saying that all world religions are the same, because I don't actually think that they are. They all have a unique diversity which we should treasure. But I do think that there are some core messages that we find across all of them. And I think this message about love and the message about the need for interpersonal relationship is one of those. And even that sense of love being divine and being incarnate, we see in other world religions as well. I mean, if you look at Hinduism for one. I don't know if I fully answered your question about heart.
Yeah, I've mentioned this two or three times during some of these events. In the 70s, I think it was 1974 or something like that,
James Lynch, are you familiar with him? He wrote, was doing cardiac research at the University of Maryland, and all of a sudden he discovered that a lot of these broken hearts were broken hearts. I mean, emotionally. And so he wrote a book called The Broken Heart that basically talks about a lot of this. And then he found the language of the heart. And he says pretty much the same thing, that there's a mind, there's a brain, there's an intelligence there. And it was fascinating to me. I mean, it opened up all kinds of doors, but it also opened up a lot of questions. But that language of the heart, I wish we could talk more about it. I wish there were more discussion. It's powerful. I just couldn't believe what I was reading. It's incredible.
Well, and I think a lot of this is just new, too. I mean, even if it's one or two decades old, it's still new. I mean, there hasn't been time to fully develop all of it. And the other thing we have in our world is information overload. So disseminating information, when there's so much information that's just out there, how do you get a message out there, get more people to know about something when they have 30 million other things trying to grab their attention every day?
There's one other, I guess it's connected to a degree.
Any thoughts? thoughts on how we layer this kind of consciousness over our societal, cultural, and political life?
Well, that was part of what my challenge was in my question. That was part of what my challenge to all of you is, you know, in terms of how do we address society? You know, we are not in a culture where interpersonal relations, well, I shouldn't say that. In some ways, you know, people are obsessively interpersonal, but it's all focused on a me and you relationship, not a we. It's the me map and the you map, and we're losing all of the we map, I think. And so starting to sort of stretch people's minds to think about what it means to expand your circle so that it's not just the people. So when I initially wrote the challenge page, and I deleted it because I didn't think we'd have time to talk about it, I had two other challenges on here. One was social media, which research is showing is actually changing our brains. Ilya Delio suggests, and she's following other people, I think, but you know, talks about the fact that the human brain is actually in the process of evolving. The human brain of children who've been raised in the digital world is actually different than, and I'm looking around and I think most of us are what they would call digital immigrants, where we were not raised that way. The brain is changing in response to that. Not all in bad ways, but in some ways that are of cause for concern in terms of this research. But the other one is xenophobia. And xenophobia is a fancy way of saying fear of the other, fear of what is other than you. And so in our society, and you can call it the Google effect, or you know, we tend to be surrounding ourselves with people that think like us. We tend to be reading opinions of people we already agree with. And everything in sort of the social media world, Facebook, et cetera, Google, reinforces that isolation. And so without deliberately breaking out of our isolated circles and engaging the other and allowing them to be other rather than trying to make them like us, I'm not sure how much progress is going to happen very quickly, at least. I'd like to think progress will happen, but ideas, yeah. Creating human relations. know other people in personal relationship is how you break down barriers, whether those are political barriers or ideological barriers. And they found this in studies. I mean, not just in terms of, you know, ad hoc human persons, but there was a, and I'm a little bit just going off of my memory and listening to NPR, but I remember a while back they did a story on this about people, it was actually around the issue of gay marriage, and one of the things like Proposition 8, it might have even been Proposition 8, I'm not sure, but they had people going around house to house and ringing the doorbells, and when someone would sit down and talk with them, and they would hear people's stories. Not that everybody changed their minds on the issue, but when it was suddenly not an issue, and it was a person who was sitting in front of you, who was telling you their life story, and what this issue meant to them and how it impacted them, people changed their minds. It's an amazing thing.
Yeah, you just said the magic word, story.
Yeah.
I'm a storyteller and have for years
power of storytelling. Beyond magic, beyond, I mean, who was one of the master storytellers? Jesus, right? Always beginning with once upon a time. And physiological changes, the endorphins, the metadata, it's just incredible. And I just wanted to share in response to this gentleman's question about what, you know, how does this start? I've had a wonderful experience. Of course, I don't know, I don't think there are too many Trump supporters in here, but I'm going to take a wild guess here. I was, what am I going to do? I'm one person. What can I do? And I started calling other Republicans who were pushing back in whatever areas. I cannot tell you the conversations that I have had, not with John McCain or McCloskey, but with people in their office, and how common ground emerged. Now, this is just one, you know, or two people, or three people, or whatever it is, but that's, I think, where it starts. And we had so much more in common than we realized, but I just wanted to tell them, I'm a lifelong Democrat, but I appreciate, applaud, and respect your courage to push back, you know, when you, so it was that mutual respect, I think. But you mentioned the word, and I have to admit, story. Storytelling is at the core.
And I would just add that that gets that empathy going. Stories engage our empathy, and that's, we are, part of our human nature is to be empathic. It's part of how we're created. And again, that's where I bring all of this back to in terms of my own core spirituality. Is that we're created this way. This is how we were made. I mean, to look at the physiology of it, is to say this is how we were made to be. And that to me is amazing.
Maybe one more or two more questions. Do you have a question?
Just getting the dodge.
Oh, right. You know, this isn't something I've read a whole lot about, I have to say. But, you know, the little bit that I did read about it, and I suppose this is a little bit my attitude to a lot of discoveries. It's like, to me, it's not, oh, we discovered a gene that explains why people believe there's a God, therefore, there's not really a God. It's like, wow, God created us with this gene that enables us to conceptualize the idea of a God. And to me, it's just one more piece of evidence that we're hardwired to be in relationship, not just with one another, but with something higher than us, with something sacred, something divine. But I will give the caveat that that's a take on it, not having read a lot about it.
Can you give some background to that question?
The God Gene? You know, there's actually a book, I think, called God Gene. But it was, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago? Maybe, I don't know. Okay, so I see, I collapse time now. I'm getting older, so I still think I'm in my 20s. I see, I talk to my students, and they're like, oh yeah, I'm not your age anymore, am I? But yeah, so it was a while back. No, but they found, you could probably answer this better than I could.
Well, I know the time that you covered it, that wasn't quality. The book, the research that was done prior to that. So the time you'd like your take on it. I said, no, it actually enables us with something that God gave us both to experience for his glory and things like that, versus that little dot right there, that's what they leave us or that's what they get it from.
Right. Right. Yeah. So it was just this discovery of the heart in us that enables us, and again, don't quote me on this because I might not be saying this exactly right, that enables us to conceptualize the idea of God. And there was some response to this of sort of dismissing God, like, okay, now we've nailed down in the human brain why humans believe in God.
Any other questions? I have one last one. Folks. We have
Ellen. It seems to me that as a professional, I'm a former retired teacher, and it looks like in our society today, children often resolve a conflict or a problem with another child by seeing use of guns or weapons, instead of thinking of God as person, as love, as compassion. And until we find the way to the path to peaceful resolution of problems, we will have violence and killing and awful behavior.
Absolutely, and I guess that's where I would again go back to a lot of this research, that in those children, particularly the children who are coming from homes where they've experienced trauma, where they've experienced neglect, where they've grown up with violence embedded in their lives, they've witnessed domestic abuse, they've witnessed people murdered, people that they love have been killed, people that they love have been incarcerated, and they've been separated from them for all various reasons. What happens is these connections between what Siegel would call their upstairs brain and their downstairs brain don't exist. Or I should say they don't exist. They're severely truncated. And so they don't have the ability that I have to stop when I get angry and take a step back and say, okay, I'm going to walk away from this, or okay. This was an interesting thing, and I wrote about this in a different piece I wrote recently. Or maybe it was the Beauty and the Beast piece. Anyways, it was that piece. But so when you have children who suffer this trauma, they exist in what's called a state of hyperarousal, which means that their fear, their fight or flight response is sort of always on its edge. And this study showed that on a scale of 0 to 10 of adrenaline, most of us exist at a state of zero. I shouldn't just say children, because then they become adults, and these are adults. They exist at a level of about 5 or 6 on that scale. And so when something happens that might take me up to about a 1 or a 2 on that adrenaline scale, suddenly they're at a 7 or an 8. And their response is very different. And they don't have the executive function that enables them to calm their fear, to modulate that response. So they react to the situation, and they react with their fight or flight response. And so if their tendency is towards aggression, they react aggressively. And then put a gun in their hands because of the prevalence of guns in our society, and you end up with tragedy.
Our children whose parents have abandoned them, and most of us can think of someone we know. So they have reason to be frustrated.
Absolutely. There's a lot of work being done on this in terms of what's called adverse childhood incidents or adverse childhood experiences. And the number of adverse childhood experiences that you have directly impact these connections and these abilities. And I think to go back to the good news is with loving people in their lives, and it doesn't have to be parents, it can be teachers, it can be people in the church, it can be people in society, with adults who can create loving relationships, and people in the Big Brother, Big Sister program that create loving relationships with them, their brains will heal. And so that's I think that's the way we've got to go down.
Not that, folks.
Take one last one. Yes.
Yeah. This is just a comment on something
them and hold them and sing to them and rock them. And so at least for those kids, they're going to at least begin their lives thinking, this is not such a bad place because there are people who want to take care of me. And if they come into the life with that attitude rather than, oh my gosh, everything is against me and the world's a horrible place, you know, maybe the violence will resolve. And it's on a one-to-one relating sort of thing. It's not a huge, big program. I mean, it's just one child and one cover at a time.
Well, and that's where we talked before about where you should start. I would say it's one child, one person at a time. I mean, you can't necessarily make a difference in every child's life, but you can make a difference in one child's life, and that's a start.
So I think we'll close it there. So let's give Heidi a round. Thank you.